been here.
Don't compare the two.
I don't.
All right, folks, it's 7 o'clock, so we'll go ahead and get started. Appreciate everyone's attendance on this chilly evening. Winter seems to be not letting us go here early on in the year, so I do appreciate everyone coming out. We've had three previous hearings. Many of you are those that I can see in the audience. Many of you attended the previous three of some variation or another. And we've taken a lot of public comment, both in these settings and then privately as well, whether those are internet comments, telephone comments, in-person comments. We've had quite a lot of public comments, so we appreciate the participation from the public. This is an important decision, and I know the committee appreciates everyone participating in the process because it's important. A couple ground rules I'll just mention again. Well, first of all, let me say what the purpose of the meeting is tonight. So since we've had three public comments, I'm going to limit public comment to about 5 minutes. So we're going to talk about things where people who have not previously spoken at any of the previous hearings can come forward and say what they want to say. And if it's something new that we haven't heard from the previous three, then come forward. Otherwise, this is going to be mostly a working session. I have a couple of proposals that we're going to talk about. And the committee can ask questions, and folks from the audience obviously can ask questions of that as we're in that process. And then we're going to take this for a couple of weeks and digest it, and then we'll probably come back the last week of November and make committee action. So that's the purpose of tonight. We've all basically agreed that that's the appropriate way to proceed at this point, because we've taken a lot more public comment than we typically do in the committee process, and I think that folks are prepared to take that information to heart. So, and again, so any ground rules, when you come forward, there's a microphone at the top. The power is on for it. When the red light's on, you are on the speaker. Please state your name for the record so I can clearly hear it for the minutes. And then state your point. And if we could be helpful to each other by not heckling one another or speaking amongst yourselves while someone is speaking so we can hear clearly, we would appreciate that. If you can silence your cell phones, that would be helpful. Last time went really well. I don't think we'll have too many issues there, so I appreciate everyone. And then as far as what comments we want, again, the purpose of what we're discussing is a proposed dispensary ban or zoning. So I know we want to talk about the topic of medical marijuana itself, since we have no power to regulate medical marijuana itself or the use of medical marijuana. I'd like you to keep your comments to a minimum about that or not mention it. We're here to discuss zoning. That's the purpose of this committee hearing. That's the purpose of what we're planning, and that's what the ultimate result will be, is about zoning. So I appreciate the emotion, and I know everyone is emotionally charged about this issue, and I respect that, and I can appreciate that, but it isn't germane to our conversation. So while I appreciate that, I know people are going to do what they do, and so I don't want to have to gavel anyone down. So I'll go ahead and start it now. So first of all, I'll take comments from the committee. Does anyone have any opening comments? No, they're ready to move on. Mr. Mayor, do you have an opening comment or anything to announce? Okay, we'll leave it for the conversation. All right, so I would just ask anyone who has not previously been in a hearing before and wants to make comments, come forward real fast. Again, state your name for the record.
Yeah, I'm Scott Ryan.
Thank you, Scott.
And I'm a registered nurse, if you didn't know me as well, and I've missed all three meetings. This is the fourth one. And I have worked from Plentywood to Superior to Flathead Valley, down to Hardin and Baker Air, Montana areas. And as an ER nurse, I've got it for 18 years. And what I perceive is when somebody comes in the emergency room, they usually have marijuana on them, and they have meth and alcohol. And that's how it runs. And we have always, we get slapped around, spit on, beat. And the sheriffs are usually in there with us, and they just kind of stare at us. We can't hit back, of course. And we have to do our best. But in my own opinion, since I've been doing this, in the last 18 years, each year gets worse in the emergency room. And like I said again, it's always starts with the marijuana, you know, then it goes to the alcohol, and then they turn the meth on. And it's not only men and women, it is all ages. And I experience it constantly. Thanks.
Thank you. Further comments? Anybody who's not discussed before?
Hi, my name is Kevin Barada. I'm an intern at Northern Montana Hospital. Councilman, thank you for allowing us to have these talks and hear both sides. I want to make two comments, if that's okay. Number one is just quickly on the medical marijuana side. This is the only meeting I have attended, but I know there was a heated discussion regarding the use of medical marijuana. You hear a lot of anecdotal evidence of it helping, but what you don't hear is the detriments that can happen with marijuana. There are cognitive impairment, there are other gateway things that we see in the medical community. And from a medical standpoint at this time, there is no indication for widespread use of marijuana. It is indicated in intractable illness or other things in the absolute cancer, pain, things like that, but it is not ready for widespread use. And all of the medical societies would propose further study, but at this time there is no indication for widespread use. On the topic of zoning, I'd like to make one comment. Number one, marijuana is still classified as a level one narcotic, which means by definition that there is no medical benefit that outweighs the risks. And so I think as a town, we have to decide whether we want to advertise a Schedule I narcotic with no proven benefit to our children, grandchildren, et cetera. Thank you.
Thank you. Further comments?
Hi, I'm Pam Pallotta, and yes, I'm a relative, but I didn't know either. He didn't know I was going to be here. I didn't know he was going to be here. So I'm glad that the council's looking at regulations from other cities. I think it's important for us as a city about what message we're sending to our youth. And I hope that our city would either ban this or at least regulate it. And my concern is for youth, because I think if we don't do anything, we're giving the indication that there is not a problem and that that there can't be negative effects, which in fact they can. And the reason I missed the last meeting is we were in Arizona, and ironically, before we left there, I was just reading in the newspaper, and it has a driver being a 19-year-old girl being charged with manslaughter for having a car accident where her passenger was killed, and her blood tested for THC, the psychoactive ingredient in marijuana. And so this has negatively affected her life, potentially the rest of her life. It certainly affected her passenger, as he has no life. So I just think we need to think about what message we're sending to the youth in whatever regulations we establish. Thank you.
Further comments?
I'm Debbie Matray, and I'm a provider. I don't have a problem with your zoning as long as it is accessible to the patients. I'm not talking everybody in general, but a lot of people don't have vehicles. They have to depend on other people, and so if you can look upon zoning as not being 20 miles out of town or whatever, but have it being accessible for the clients that we all have, then I think that would be a good thing. I understand that you don't want it here in town. I personally don't have a downtown dispensary or anything at this moment. I had been planning on opening one, but you know, I'm still running my business where I run my business. You know, so I think zoning needs to really be looked at as helpful with the clients.
Thank you. Further comments? Folks, there's some seats down front. If you want to have a chair, you can certainly use these, probably six or seven.
Hi, my name is Yvette Morse. I have a couple of comments to make about marijuana. I'm a pharmacist, and so I have a little bit more insight into some of the medical things. And I think there are some legitimate uses for it, but there are not 300 people in Hill County who are legitimately needing marijuana. The other thing that I have a grave concern about is the fact that medical marijuana is legal in Montana, but they have not set up the infrastructure for it. They don't have the licensing, they don't have the inspections, they don't have fees, and until that happens, I think HABR would be well to say, not here, and maybe look at it in a couple of years when there are regulations that will protect the city and the operators and the public. The other comment, because it is a Schedule I narcotic, legally the legitimate banks cannot take money as from these businesses. So you end up having a cash business that, what are they going to do with the money? And my concern is what's going to happen to our law enforcement when you have a cash business that cannot just go down to the bank and deposit their money and everybody knows it. I think we're inviting trouble that we don't need.
Thank you, Elaine. Further comments? Yes,
sir. Thanks, Cody. So my thought on this deal, I missed the meetings. I was out of state working. And, you know, I did some studying when the idea was brought up. And, you know, I don't think there's anything wrong with letting people have the freedom of choice of what kind of medicine they want to use that has been deemed okay by the state of Montana. I myself am not in need of it, but in the future, like, you know, a lot of guys that do the work I do end up getting cancer. So, you know, I look at that as an issue that could be a problem for me in the future. And I think I'd be one to be in tune with the medical marijuana as a medicine as opposed to taking pharmaceuticals that are going to kill your liver that much faster and other parts of your body. So, you know, I think that, you know, trying to make it harder for people to make those kind of decisions is somewhat not 100% fair. You know, I see where you guys are coming from, where you're worried about, you know, the spread of crime and, you know, things like that, or, you know, influence. But, you know, I was just down in Helena, you know, a couple weeks ago, downtown Helena, and the capital of Montana has a dispensary right there, plain as day, big sign. You know, people brought up the fact about signs. I mean, that's a joke, but, you know, we're talking big old signs, says medical marijuana right there next to the Women's Park downtown. You know, and that's the capital. You know, how does the governor feel about it? You know, how does all the people from government that go in and out of there feel about it? You know, I guess I just don't see the difference here, other than, you know, the being scared of a progression of choice. You know, if you're worried about zoning, you know, figure out the zoning, but don't make it so unreasonable that people can't, you know, get what they want to choose to have. You know, as for like the federal rules involved, you know, yeah, that's still there, but I mean, how many more states just legalized it? You know, there was just an election where it's expanded. You know, I mean, why try to nip this back when it's going to come up again in the future? I mean, all you're going to do is delay the inevitable if it all becomes legal on a federal level. You know, the state level, it's already there. So I guess I don't see why trying to hold back on progression is, you know, the goals, when some people look at it as a way to move forward, when you could figure out a way to make taxes on it and make those taxes work for the city. You know, if there was a way to funnel it into the roads, there you go, you know. You know, that's just my thoughts, you know, and like I said, I haven't made a meeting. I've seen a lot of other people that are, you know, in need of it, you know, asking, you know, not to all of a sudden take this away, You know, I mean, was this an issue when it was legalized, you know, what was it, 3 years ago, 4 years ago?
2008.
Yeah.
That's before, technically.
Okay, so.
Became an issue.
And I mean, yeah, I do remember reading some stuff that went down with that, but you know, the thing is, if you can get the right kind of people regulating it, maybe give somebody a job, you know, or two, or, you know, the state might be able to work with the liaison and you guys, but, you know, I just feel like, you know, I mean, you can all outban it or you can zone it. I just don't think all outbanning would be 100% fair to the people, you know, on the city level. But if you figured out a way to regulate it better, you might be able to figure out a way to tax it if it's possible.
It's not legal for us to tax it.
But.
Violation of state law.
Yeah. All right.
Thanks, sir. Further comments? Come forward, sir.
Well, I just didn't hear what the comment you made to him. I was just trying to.
Oh, he said maybe if we could figure out how to appropriately zone it, perhaps we can tax for it. It's currently not a, municipalities and counties, local government cannot tax it. Only the state can tax it at this current level. So that was just my comments.
Okay, well, my name's Pat Freed. I'll come up to the mic.
Sure, please come forward.
And my thing is, you want to zone this? I have a question about the zoning. You want to zone it so it's out of the city? Is that correct?
No, sir. What we would do, we have multiple options, but my proposal would be one of two things. Well, three things. We'll get into the third option in a minute. But if we were to zone it, it would be regulated within city limits. If we were to ban it, it would not be permitted in city limits. And again, we're just speaking about the dispensaries.
Okay. Now, my understanding is we're going broke. Basically, Hatter's going broke. We're losing people. All of our kids are moving out of town. Because they basically can't get jobs. Now you want to close a business that's bringing in a revenue? Where's the money going to come from? Are you going to raise our tax? Are the property taxes again to cover this? Because as far as I know, taxes don't go down; they always go up. Who's going to pay for that? We are. But then you're going to say, okay, well then you can't have this business here, but you can have a bar right next door to it. But we're going to zone you out. So then you lose that revenue too. I believe you get revenue from when you're renting a house. You get property. Is that correct?
Yes, the landowners pay property taxes.
So then you're going to lose that because you basically can't pay property taxes and close it down.
No, sir, that wouldn't be true because the real property would still exist. We collect property taxes on the real property.
From who?
From the property owner. So if the building is there, we get property
and
taxes.
And he says, I can't pay it. What are you going to do? Are you going to sue the property?
That's, yeah, there's a process for that.
And then, if you got nobody here to buy the property, what are you going to do with it?
Okay. Comments understood. Thank you. Further comments from the public? Further comments? Yes, ma'am.
My name is Kelly LeBoy.
Yeah.
And I think what I am on the same page as that last gentleman, and what I think he's talking about also is a business brings in revenue. A needed business in a community brings other revenue into the community through this business supplies a need to, like you said, I think last time, 209 cardholders.
Yeah.
So at least right here in Hill County or?
That was Hill County.
Hatter. Oh.
There's no, it doesn't break
out. Okay, so just in Hill County, that's 200 families that we know of that would need access to that medication. And the surrounding communities also come to this community then to get medication that they need. And then when they come in, because I know when I go out, when I go to Great Falls or when I go to Helena, I spend a lot of money there. I spend grocery money and everything else. And so when those people come to town, I know for a fact they go grocery shopping and they spend a lot of other money. So you also have the income from the taxes, like you were saying, if that place owns the property or they rent the property, then they're contributing also to the community. And as a council, I think you're representing the whole community as a whole. So I think there's been an awful lot of people that have came here and spoke and told you all how they feel and the need that they have. And more so than people who have came and said, no. And I think those who haven't came speak too by saying, they're not really that worried about it, and they're not that concerned about it. If they were, they would be here. Like the people that are here asking for the consideration.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll take a couple more and then we're ready to move on. Further comments? Further comments?
Hi, Kim, you guys know me. When speaking with community members and city council members about these issues, I was consistently given one piece of advice: be respectful when addressing the council. This happens to be exactly what every single medical cannabis cardholder expects from this council: respect, compassion, human decency, and not to be treated as second-class citizens and criminals because we choose legal medicinal cannabis for our ailments instead of deadly opioids and other pharmaceuticals. Chief Mattis, you have previously stated that crime rates increase in areas of medical cannabis dispensary. This information is incorrect. In your packets, there's 5 studies. These studies are from reputable, it's not from the cannabis industry. They're from reputable organizations. The first one is a study from the National Center of Biotechnology Information, and exploring the ecological association between crime and medical marijuana dispensaries, there was no observed cross-sectional association between the density of medical marijuana dispensaries and either violent or property crime rates in the study. These results suggest that the density of medical marijuana dispensaries may not be associated with crime rates. A second report. These findings run counter to arguments suggesting the legalization of marijuana for medical purposes poses a danger to public health in terms of exposure to violent crimes and property crimes. Study number 3. Our conclusion is that state marijuana legalizations have had minimal effect on marijuana use and related outcomes. The absence of significant adverse consequences is especially striking, given the sometimes dire predictions made by legalization opponents. Number 4, going to pot. This study is very interesting because it was conducted in 2010 after the state of California ordered the closure of 400 dispensaries. Contrary to popular wisdom, we find an immediate increase in crime around dispensaries ordered to close relative to those allowed to remain open. Contrary to conventional wisdom, we find no evidence that closures decrease crime. Instead, we find a significant relative increase in crime around closed dispensaries. As you know, a lot has changed in California since 2010 and now has legalized medicinal and recreational. Study, I could have brought 50 more studies that say the same thing, but I didn't. They all show the exact same thing. Crime rates decrease as a result of allowing legitimate cannabis dispensaries. Number 5 in your book is a study: is legal pot crippling Mexican drug trafficking organizations, the effects of medical marijuana laws on U.S. crime. We show that the introduction of medical marijuana laws leads to a decrease in violent crimes in states that border Mexico. The reduction in crime is strongest for counties close to the border and for crimes that relate to drug trafficking. In addition, we find that medical marijuana laws in inland states lead to a reduction in crime in the nearest border states. Our results are consistent with the theory that decriminalization of the production and distribution of marijuana leads to a reduction in violent crime in markets that are traditionally controlled by Mexican drug trafficking organizations. Now, this study is pretty intriguing in light of the fact that the Mexican drug cartel is very alive and doing very, very well on the Rocky Point Indian Reservation as we speak. And if they're there, they're here in the hours. If you close the doors on legal medical marijuana shops, you will be giving the Mexican drug cartel the opportunity to work on growing their illegal marijuana market in Harbor. I could go on and on for hours with the many studies that have been done regarding dispensaries and crime rates. primaries, and you now have the actual studies, statistical data. Chief Madison, you continue to express your concern about losing your federal grant monies. You stated at one of the meetings it was $390,000. You've also used $300,000. Regardless of the exact amount, the fact that you're worried about losing federal grant monies is, they are not going to come to Havre and take your money. Number six in your book is a printout of all 29 states in the District of Columbia, the percentage of federal monies they get from their cities. Not one state, not one city, not one police department, nobody's lost money. Nobody. It's not going to happen. Attachment number seven is the Montana Department of Justice's substance use in Montana. Summary of...
Can we go through all of these?
It hasn't been gone through before, because I know you guys aren't
going to read it. But you're not talking about zoning either.
No.
So, let's wrap it up.
Wow.
Yay, Kim.
Oh, I want to do one thing that you guys need to see. It's in your book, too. This is the highest risk. This is the lowest risk. There's alcohol, heroin, cocaine, tobacco, ecstasy, way at the bottom. There's cannabis.
We appreciate it, Kim. We can get in touch with you, too, as you have to discuss it.
See everybody. Cannabis is at the bottom, low risk.
One more comment, and then we've got to have this up.
My name is Mark Berger. I've spoken before with respect to the medical issues. I just have one brief comment on zoning. I live downtown. Anyone who votes for this and thinks that dispensaries are such a good idea, it's always someplace else. The ones of you who are in favor of dispensaries, the one next to your home.
That's fine. I wouldn't have to drive so far.
I'll take one more.
My question is simply this: can you have licensing, like you license for bars and things like that?
We do not license any business in Montana or in the city of Havre of any kind. So no.
Did you mean like liquor licenses?
Well, liquor licenses are a state of Montana thing again. Yeah. They're regulated by the Montana Department of Revenue.
And you're not saying those at all?
No. No. That's well, we can provide insight and opinion, if we have concern. But no, we don't regulate them. The license is determined by the Montana Department of Revenue.
Okay, thank you.
You bet. Good question. Thanks, Rick. Okay, with that, I think we're going to wrap it up, and then we're going to start a work conversation. If you do have a question, please again come forward while we're speaking, I'll recognize you at that time. So folks, what you have in front of you here is just a couple, these are my options. We don't have, and this isn't certainly done yet. We have basically, well, technically we have four choices. We could do nothing. I would hope that we not do anything, because I do think that puts us in a precarious legal situation, because our zoning doesn't reflect this business at all. We could do a temporary moratorium, which is what we were considering doing in 2010, and what a number of communities have done. I don't think we need to do that, but I'm saying that is an option. We could do that. I think we can go ahead and make one of these other choices. The two that I've proposed in writing are the proposed ban and then a proposed zoning amendment, okay? So the first one, it's pretty simple language. So the first one would be, no use of land shall be permitted or conditionally permitted within the city of Havre that is in violation of federal, state, or local law. There are other options. The city of Billings version that we looked at earlier in the year, if you remember back in August when we started this, that was one of the temporary ones before the ordinance, before the statute changed again after October 1st. For the final effective date of the act. And they were using the language that was in their ordinance was from their temporary moratorium that they issued in 2010 and every 6 months was reapproving. So when they came back, they did, yes, sir.
Can I have you speak a little closer to your mic because I'm having a hard time hearing you.
Sure. Is that better?
Yes.
A little bit better, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I apologize. Chief, can you turn it up a little bit? We'll try to do better here. Thank you, sir. So anyway, the Billings ordinance, the original Billings ordinance that mentioned storefront dispensaries and defined storefront dispensaries, which was another law document, that was originally from their initial moratorium. And they have since adopted this language, and this is the same language that Helena, Kalispell, Great Falls, most of the communities have adopted. And there's a couple of legal advantages to this one. So one is that it solves the concern that law enforcement has and other jurisdictions have about grant funding. It doesn't mention medical or recreational. So if federal law changes, we don't have to recodify the law. If it becomes legal, it's now legal. We don't need to revisit our ordinance. So that's one of the reasons that they've done that this way, is that it's the simplest and it's the most legally defensible. So I have visited with our counsel about this, and I asked her just plain English what she thought of each of these, and she said both were legally defensible in her opinion. She doesn't have an opinion either way, really, but both of these she could defend. So that's the ban. The ban is fairly simple, and it's straightforward, and that's what we would insert into our zoning document, and it would just say that plainly. And then if it became legal on the federal level, which it may, who knows, then we don't need, or if it becomes legal for recreational purposes in Montana, which may also occur before it was legalized federally, this would suffice all of those positions, medical, recreational, legal, or illegal. It handles it all and pre-codified. The secondary option would be the proposed zoning amendment. And this would be, and this is where I'm open to other comments here, but I think, let me say a couple caveats. Havre's a little different than other communities because, number one, we're not a charter, so all the other class ones are charters. Because we do not have self-governing powers, and because we do not have the level of municipal bureaucracy that most communities do with their business licensing and business regulation setups for inspections and all of that, we would be potentially legally opening ourselves up to spot zoning. If we get too much into the weeds on you can be here but not here and you need to be this far from this. And so the cleanest method would simply state that if we're open, we'd make it legal, we would put it in the most, the strictest district, which is commercial general. By the way, the two dispensaries that are currently operating, Green Relief and Blue Montana, would exist in this district currently. So there would be no impact to them at this current time. Would just simply state to add retail sales as permitted under Montana law. We could then go in and add additional restrictions about distances, for instance, like the Act has about 500 feet from a house of worship wholly within a building, that kind of language. We could certainly entertain that. I'm a little concerned about the potential exposure we have legally on spot zoning in that instance. Although it has not been tested, the cases in Billings are not relevant to either of those conversations. So it's just a concern that I have, and it's a concern that I visit with counsel about, and she would agree to an extent with me on that. But I understand that if we want to, I'm all for it, you know, whatever we want to do. But these are the two proposals outside of doing nothing and a moratorium that I think we should consider, and I'm open to language adjustments. So these are mine. And for the folks in the audience, these are not officially drafted or anything. That we can change this. We'll, at the next meeting that we'll be able to schedule, we'll bring a formal proposal forward for each of these in writing. But the consensus is, since it's a one-liner, it's fairly simple and straightforward. So I'll open it up to, Councilman Madden.
Andrew, would you tell everyone again what all the Class 1 cities in the state have done?
Yes, so currently, and there's going to be a change in classification for Class 1s with the addition of Belgrade very soon, but Billings has banned, Missoula has zoned, Great Falls has banned, Helena has banned, Butte Silver Bow has regulated, and Kalispell has banned, and Bozeman has regulated. And then Havre, we've not taken action. The city of Belgrade is currently a Class 3 city, and they're about to become a Class 1 city. They'll actually jump us in population, and they have voted to ban already. And then there are a number of Class 2s and Class 3s that already have. Hamilton, Glasgow, Malta, the ones that I can think of, there are a bunch. Dozens. Lewistown, I think, is doing it right now. There are a lot of jurisdictions that are just starting the process that we started in August, so lots of cities are just now beginning this process. So, but of all the Class 1s, all the Class 1s, but Havre has taken action in some way. Oh, Whitefish was the other class two, major class two that was banned. Yes, ma'am. It's okay.
I just have two questions for you.
Yeah.
Okay, one, if you put a moratorium, what are you talking?
Well, the only purpose of the moratorium would be that we would, so everything that happens right now would stay as it is. We wouldn't permit anybody else in.
Right.
They could be technically in violation, but those in existence would stay.
Mine that isn't open yet is still in that moratorium?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. I mean, that's.
That basically gives us breathing room to make certain decisions if we need additional funds.
My other question is if you ban from the city, what does the county have to say about this?
Well, the county would be in a different situation. See, the issue there is that most counties don't have adopted zoning outside of a certain donut. There's a regulatory area buffer zone usually around each municipality that either adopts municipal zoning out a certain distance, and there's actually a map that shows what the donut zone is in for Haver and Hill County. But outside that, most county zoning is so broad. That's what happens in other jurisdictions as well outside of Montana, Oregon, Washington, California, Colorado, that most municipalities that then vote to ban dispensaries, for instance, then push them out into the county.
Mm-hmm.
So when the gentleman came forward and said that there was one in Helena, it must have been outside city limits because in the city of Helena they're banned.
But you have not talked to the county?
No.
Commissioners at all about throwing us all out there and then it would be their problem.
Correct.
So then it would be going through all this with the commissioner. I mean, okay. All right, thanks.
Just an ominous answer for you.
Nope, that answered it.
Thank you, ma'am. That's a good question. Further question? Yes.
Just a quick question. So I guess if everything's left, let's say you did ban, are you banning the people to go get medical marijuana where it is available in Montana and bring it back for use? Is that still a ban?
No. The Montana Medical Marijuana Act allows municipalities to regulate storefront dispensaries and all dispensaries. Actually, the rewrite of the last one says all dispensaries. We don't regulate the use of medical marijuana. We don't regulate the sale of marijuana. We would just be able to regulate the business itself and the location that business would be at.
Is there any extra concern? I see there's like businesses now that are mailing direct.
We have no authority over that. The U.S. mail is federal province.
Okay.
I would not recommend anyone mail marijuana. I do think that they would have some trouble. That's just me, though. I'm not a lawyer. Good question. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I got another question. First of all, I'm going to make one comment. I don't care about other cities. I don't live there. I live here in Haver. So whatever they do, that's fine with them. This is Haver. On your zoning, do you zone for bars?
Yes.
Do you have a zoning law for that?
Yes.
Why can't you do marijuana the same way? You can have it on your zoning law on the bars. You can't have it so many feet?
That's already set up, right? Let me correct you, sir. State of Montana, just as the state of Montana has the Montana Medical Marijuana Act, a distance requirement, the Department of Revenue has for bars as well. The city of Haver does not. The city of Haver zones them, and they need to be in commercial general, which is what this proposal would do.
So it would essentially treat them the same.
It would treat them the same as bars. The distance requirement is a state issue.
What's wrong with treating them the same as bars?
I'm not arguing with you. I wrote the proposal.
Okay. I just had a curious proposal. I didn't understand your proposal.
Okay, I'm sorry. Yeah, no, that's what this proposal would be.
And both
current dispensaries are located in the proper district and would be legal if this were voted.
Okay, but if that was voted in, could another dispensary come in too?
As long as they're within the commercial general district, which is basically the downtown business district. We have a map that indicates that.
All right, so then you're saying, okay, you can have it downtown, but no more populated where schools and stuff.
And not in a residential area, just the same as a casino.
See, I got no problem with that zone.
Okay.
Right. When you say I want to ban it completely, then I do have a problem.
Okay. I also can always that. but those are the two options we're considering. Thank you, sir. Sometimes I speak beyond myself. Yes.
Could you move your mic closer, please?
Sure. we would still be in not in compliance with federal law.
Yes.
So all the federal law issues and the grant issues, which we don't get just grants from the police department, we get a lot of grants from.
No, it's for everything.
Yeah.
We got a fire department.
We get a lot of grant money.
Right.
So this would not address that issue.
No, Karen, in my opinion, and this is my opinion, then I'll address the chief and the mayor can address this as well. The only one that would solve that issue, in my opinion, and this is my opinion, because we all have an opinion about what the feds may or may not do, we can't say with any certainty anyway which way, because sanctuary cities are being attacked for this right now. So that would be the most current example of loss of federal funding for the government. Typically, in the past, it's been approached towards the user and the caregiver. That was the last federal crackdown. I won't make an opinion about that, but to answer your question, legally speaking, and I did visit with council about this, this one would solve the problem that the mayor and Chief Madison have concerning the grant funding. That is correct. It's not just from the city police department, but a current major grant we're using for the fire department. And then, of course, we get a lot of municipal grants, federal grants and federal money for board housing, for all kinds of things, CDBG, and then for infrastructure as well, for various projects and loans that would affect all of those. I don't believe the zoning will impact that, but I present it because I want the council to make the decision to basically provide cover for our other elected officials, and we're ordering them as a matter of legislative policy that we're ignoring federal law that it's on record.
As can I ask a question about that?
Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to ask about if it's banned, okay, like you're saying that the federal government could come in and pull their funding.
Correct.
From whatever federal program. Well, if they're going to do that, why wouldn't they just come in and do that to the whole state? Since the state is going against federal law by saying, state, we're.
This is a good time.
Sure, Mr. Mayor, go ahead. Come forward.
Yeah. I guess I just want to clarify for everyone where this federal funding part comes up.
Press the button.
Okay, can you hear me now? Okay, I just want to clarify this federal funding part. And I guess a lot of it's not so worried they're going to come in and pull our funding. It's a lot of it, every grant and every loan as far as with the federal dollars that we're asking, we have Buffalo Court, we have Fire Truck coming, we have Antelope Court, numerous, our wastewater project, all is, some of the projects going on, our task force, we have numerous dollars coming into our community from this. Every one of them have the same wording on it. And I guess I'm feeling I'm purging myself by signing them grants saying that we are in compliance with state and federal law. And that the federal law, it is illegal. And I guess my part is, I'm not willing to purge myself, and neither is the city attorney or anyone else, to sign one of these grants to come up with more dollars. And I guess I'm feeling the communities that are ignoring it are ignoring the thing, and maybe they want it.
Then the whole state would be ignoring the federal law.
And the state, to me, I don't know.
Then why hasn't California lost any federal funding? They've had cannabis since the 90s.
Yeah, okay. And I'm not saying what California, I guess I've been in a position that when I sign something, I read it and I believe in it, and I'm not going to sign something that purges me in my position. And that's why I'm laying it out there. I feel only one of these actually covers us and we can move forward. But.
Mr. Mayor, just so
I'm. Well, see, that
folks,
seems like
folks,
it's boiling down to a personal belief,
that.
Though.
Just
you know, this is not just a personal matter.
Sir?
Okay. Yeah, and you all have your opinion that you could have ran for this job and signed them if you wanted. I guess it was open. I have worked many years. I have my opinion of marijuana and law enforcement. I've seen it. I've been out there as chair and coroner in this community for almost 30 years, and I do have a very strong opinion that prevention is a big part of it.
Mr. Mayor,
so I do believe in.
Just to clarify, are you saying that if we were to go with the second option, the zoning amendment, you would refuse to sign federal grants going forward?
I'm feeling that, yeah. I would. The grant has that wording, as long as they're willing to leave that wording in there.
So when was the last time you signed a federal grant, if I can ask? Or we as a city or the police department or the fire department?
probably airport, not too long.
Okay.
But.
Police department's monthly draw.
Sure.
Isn't yours a monthly draw?
Quarterly.
Quarterly draw.
So, but we currently have dispensaries in the city limits, and you've been bashing those checks every month.
But, but we are in the process, and I felt as long as we're in the process of correcting it.
You're gonna do it one at a time, and you're gonna be respectful. No shouting out, please. Be respectful.
I'm just trying to explain the reasoning, and maybe they won't come after it.
They won't.
Okay, the next person that shouts out is gonna be asked to leave, okay?
I just want.
And you asked it all several times now. That's it.
It's not helpful.
Next person that shouts out of turn, without his direction, gonna be asked to leave.
Caleb, I guess one point to your point is that because we don't have any decision at all about medical marijuana dispensaries, they're not technically legal or illegal currently, we have a little more legal defense than we would if we took positive action. That is, and that has been the determination of city attorneys throughout Montana on this issue.
Can I
I'm
ask?
Not saying it's right,
sure.
I'm just saying that.
So maybe Mayor Tim or Chief or maybe Andrew, have we received any sort of memos or letters or guidance from any of the federal grant administrators telling us that we are at risk for losing grant funding because of Montana's Medical Marijuana Act?
I haven't had anything direct.
No. Okay. The reason I ask is because it seems to me that is maybe one of the major sticking points here is this concern about the grant money, because I keep seeing you repeating it in the newspaper and I believe it's been on the radio, and that's, in my mind, that's one of the big questions here. So I've been trying to do some research on the topic of grants and medical marijuana, and as Kim mentioned, as far as I can find, no municipality or state has lost any federal dollars because of any medical marijuana acts in any state over the last decade. The only thing that I have found is a memo written during the Obama administration called the Cole Memo. And you can Google that, you might be aware.
Codified by Rohrabacher.
Yeah. And it essentially states that as long as a state's medical marijuana laws are taking certain steps to prevent drug trafficking, the use of marijuana by minors, certain concerns like that, interstate travel with marijuana, that sort of thing, that the federal government would not step on those state toes. Is that essentially the spirit of that memo?
Right. The order was an executive order written by the Justice Department, the Cole Amendment that Obama signed as an executive order that indicated that the Justice Department may not expend or appropriate money to prosecute medical marijuana or recreational marijuana crimes in the federal jurisdiction within jurisdictions that have adopted it through states' rights. It was then codified in congressional law by the Rohrabacher rule. Rohrabacher Carr is what it is, but that sunsets at the end of 17, and Congress has not reauthorized it.
Sure.
And Attorney General Sessions has been on at least five times asking them not to do that.
Yeah. Well, actually, just this very week, Jeff Sessions, I think on Tuesday, during you have to copy that. This was from Forbes, not exactly a pro-medical marijuana organization. During a congressional hearing this week, Jeff Sessions essentially stated that he has no plan to change federal policy compared to the Obama administration's policy. He basically says our policy is the same fundamentally as the Holder-Lynch policy, which includes the Cole Memo.
And I'll just clarify that. He actually said, that was in the House hearing.
In
the Senate hearing a week ago, he said that he's asking Congress. So his reflection here is that that's the current policy because it hasn't sunsetted yet, and Congress's amendment that was a defense appropriation rider is what it's applied to. It's still in effect. So his policy can't change. What he's asking Congress to do is lift it or let it expire, and then he will. So this we can go both ways with this. Ma'am, you've been standing there a while.
Yes, I have. My name is Theron Williams, T-H-E-R-O-N. I have some questions about the grant portion of it. I work for a couple of nonprofits around this community, And when we go through and apply for a grant and we make up a budget packet and all of that, we put in there, you know, what we're going to use the money for, how it's going to be distributed throughout the community and throughout the program. It's listed in there how much will go to our admin, whatever maintenance costs that we have. So I suppose what my question is, how, when you make up these budgets and apply for these grants, in there you don't mention anything about local dispensaries or medical marijuana use around the community, correct? So how would that impact the amount of money in the grants that you're applying for? That's my question.
It don't affect it, but to accept that grant, you're saying you're following all federal laws.
There's a statement at the bottom of the draw request that indicates that you will be in full compliance with all federal laws and regulations under the penalty of perjury.
But currently, the federal policy is they will abide by state regulations as long as they're being certain.
As a matter of federal prosecution.
Sure.
That doesn't mean the individual department's cat.
I guess I'm rather disturbed by the mayor's comment that he would refuse to sign any further grants or cash any further grant checks.
Yeah, as am I. I feel like the money that's coming into the community won't even affect that portion at all. So I think that that's a concern that while it's valid, I very strongly don't believe from the grant writing perspective and the grant giving perspective that that's going to...
You're entitled to your opinion.
Yeah, negatively.
Yeah. It is the main legal concern the other communities use as well in their legal discrimination. I guess I would just ask a question and I'll play devil's advocate, because I think everyone knows how I feel about this personally, but as a matter of policy, you're going to waive it and require the mayor to perjure himself?
No, I guess as a matter of policy, I would prefer that we respect Montana law
and more federal law.
No, because this doesn't, what we would have here wouldn't mention marijuana at all. It's the only thing we're permitting anything under Montana law, and then that's on Montana. If the feds wanted to crack down on the state law, and I don't think they would, but if they did, then that would affect how many states and
29
states and the District of Columbia. So a majority of states would also be at a similar risk. So
just to clarify then, sorry, even though it is legal to own a dispensary in the state of Montana, those papers will not be signed because it's not federally legal, correct?
Right.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
I find it very interesting that there are a number of people, including one of our councilmen, and with an audience of how many government students from the high school, recommending that we break federal law. That does not make sense to me.
So are you saying that if that's your position, then all of the grant money that we've accepted since the moment a dispensary opened up its doors in Havre,
that's already been explained, Caleb.
But we're still allowing medical marijuana dispensaries currently.
Would you tell him again, Andrew?
By having no local laws, we're just acceding to the state law. State law is in violation, then we're in violation.
That's one view of it. The other view of it is an affirmative defense because we have not taken specific action to proactively permit it. That's the other defense. So we have an attorney here. Maybe he wants to join the conversation here, but it all comes down to which legal argument would suffice.
And you called it right when you said we don't know what the feds will do. Many of you may remember that after...
Brian, do you want to state your name for the record?
I'm trying a little bit.
Thank you.
Medical marijuana was legalized over a year ago, and the state backed off. The feds had a memorandum that said we're not going to enforce it. Colorado didn't, California didn't, Washington didn't, and we had a U.S. attorney in this state by the name of Mike Cotter who chose to enforce it. He prosecuted a lot of people whose only involvement was following Montana state law. They all were convicted or pled. One gentleman who simply leased a warehouse was charged with receiving proceeds from a drug operation, tried it, and was convicted. So what the feds will or won't do, we don't know. It was very disturbing that Cotter chose to do that in Montana and the other states that were much larger, much greater population, much more economic impact. The attorneys in those states did not act. So my question to you, Tim, would be, it is on the bottom of every grant. It does create that issue if you sign it and you know you're in violation of federal law, you potentially are opening yourself up to loss of the grant. Whether they ever prosecute is who knows. But what efforts have been made to contact the people that draft those forms, that send those forms out, to say, given where we're at with this state and what the law is in the state and the state's rights issues that come into play, which the government generally, particularly the Republicans, are very strong about states' rights. So I'm curious, has anybody tried to change the form and have that objectionable language removed and just eliminate that issue? It's a matter of a form that nobody's enforcing. So anyway, that'd be my question.
Or at the very least, to ask for some clarification from those administrators, whether they feel that medical marijuana would put us in violation of the law.
You know, I was just going to say that, ask that same question. Why not take this, you know, proposal to the next level and say, you know, Mr. Governor, how do we proceed with this without, you know, causing us to, you know, I mean, I respect all you do, Mr. Solomon, you know, and your service and that. But, you know, if it becomes a personal issue when this is a matter of it being a right to the people that was voted in which I'm all about the freedom, and I understand what you're seeing there too on your side, and that, you know, I can see the criminal aspects is what you're worried about, but you got to move it up to the next level and be like, you know, what do we do here? You know, you got people that want this, but we at the administrative levels are worried about implications to ourselves for signing documents, you know, that could, you know, put things at risk in jeopardy, you know, for the sake of the people. So, you know, I don't understand, you know, if you guys are looking at all these cities, have you guys sat down with the cities and talked to them straight to face to face? Okay. And what about the governor? Or what about the governor?
The governor is no relevance
to the people in the legislature. They run the state. I mean, those guys run the state, right?
Right. But our concern is with federal law, not with state law.
Well, if the thing is ask the governor for advice. Go to those guys.
For what?
For what?
Ask him.
Say, you know, we got all this going on. I mean, how do you proceed? I mean, you've got a dispensary downtown Helena. How do you feel about it? You know?
Thank you, sir.
I mean, I think it is a good, it's a valid question. Have we asked anybody at the federal level? Any of the, because you have contacts that work with you on these grants. Have you asked them about that signature on the bottom and whether they care about medical marijuana?
Not on this particular issue, but on other issues within forms, yeah, they don't change.
So,
and so
I'm not so much concerned about the changing as their interpretation of it. If in their mind, the administrator of the grant says, I don't care about medical marijuana, the feds don't care about medical marijuana right now, go ahead and sign it. Would you refuse to sign it at that point?
Yeah, on some administrator's word, yeah.
You would sign it or you wouldn't?
It's pretty obvious wording. To me, you don't need the interpretation of violation of federal law.
And they do update the language fairly often. In fact, Gabe sent me the last four, and every one of the last four has gotten a little deeper each time. Not with respect to medical marijuana, but just lawyers are terrible people because they just keep adding pages and pages of limitations and restrictions. So, yes, sir.
Hi, Lucas Minnick. I live here. So, I assume that the advantage of actually having a zoning policy as opposed to doing nothing is that a dispensary couldn't open up in somewhere outside of the commercial district? Is that the idea?
Yes, it would give us power.
So, I'm just spitballing here, but what if you rephrase the proposal to ban dispensaries in everywhere except the business district, That way you're not affirmatively proposing that dispensaries are okay, but it's in effect doing the same thing, and then you could get out of this perjury loophole.
The result would be the same because we'd be permitting it somewhere in our jurisdiction.
But you're not saying that. You're just saying no. Just it's just not
well, Caleb,
accessible.
Technically, right? Legally speaking, we're not saying it at all.
Well, I mean, you, so you just it, it's all the proposition would be you can't do it in these areas. We're not speaking to other areas because the concern here. I mean, to be frank, if we're just looking at what we're doing, perjury is already being committed, right? I mean, like we're allowing it. We're saying we're not seeing that, right? Well, I mean, couldn't we rephrase the proposition?
It's a defense. Yeah. We believe we have the.
It just seems to me like we could eat our cake and eat it here. I mean, have our cake and eat it. Like, just say, well, anyway, that's my opinion. If you want it zoned that way, just say it's not allowed in these zones. Be silent on the other zones. Then you get out of the perjury thing, and you can have your zoning effect. The social issues have already been beaten to death. I think everybody knows how the other people feel, but I feel like
right.
This one technical hang-up, we could maybe get out of it.
Okay, thanks, sir, for your comments. Further comments? Chief?
Just maybe it should have a little bit light as far as how the grant works, especially with the pastoral. The federal government, well, I'm not sending down the money to
pressure, but.
So the federal government sends the money down to the state, the MPCC. Okay. That's where we draw it down from. So that's how we get that.
The Montana Board of Credit.
Right, yeah. And it's a quarter of a year.
So the state already has this money, even though the state has medical marijuana for us. Is that what you're saying?
So the federal government sends money down to the state, the Montana Board of Crime Control, who then awards the grants to the agents that apply. Okay, we're one of five or seven recipients of funding.
So the state of Montana is already receiving this money from the federal government.
But they're not expending it.
Right, but they are accepting it and they're passing it on
to
the
communities.
Yeah, so anyway,
just trying to clarify.
Just to, so the federal government's not going to, and the state's not going to give the drug task force funding, and then in the same token, then have the city turn around and violate federal laws. So you're getting a federal grant funding to enforce and investigate drug crime. So now, is there
what,
not going to allow
wait,
you?
Wait, I'm sorry, Chief. I'm sorry, Chief.
Yeah, hold on.
But we just covered that. We just covered that from a
right.
Criminal perspective.
Well,
the Cole memo says that the feds don't care about medical marijuana.
No, the Cole memo says that the Justice Department cannot prosecute medical marijuana.
So if you're
smiling, it doesn't say you can't expend money.
Okay.
So we have to be in compliance with federal law, and I'll give you some more examples here. So basically what I'm trying to say is the government's not going to give us a bunch of money to fight drug crimes and investigate drug crimes. At the same time, have the city violate their own laws. You can't have that. Okay? Second thing, so just recently here, how our grant works, it comes out in a quarterly. I just don't get $180,000 at one time. Every quarter I can draw down. So just recently, we go to do a drawdown, but we're denied. We can't get the funding. So what's going on? Well, you're not in compliance with the EPPOC or the Equal Opportunity Program. Well, okay, what did we do last year? Let's submit the same paperwork. Well, it didn't exist last year. This is all new. We have a new administration. So this is all new stuff that's happened. We had 8 years of another administration where it got lax and some of the stuff did not occur like it should have. So we can't draw down our money. Well, okay, so now we have to spend a couple weeks to figure out the paperwork. We have to register, we have to attest to, we have to certify that we're in compliance with all that. Once that happened, then they released the funds. And that was just recently. Now prior to that, the MBCC wanted to do an audit. So we have this audit, and shown the books and everything, and everything's perfect, everything's fine. But what the meeting ended up being more about was we were out of compliance, because each grant has additional conditions attached to it. We were out of compliance with NIBARS. Okay, so within the Drug Task Force, we have multiple agencies. it's not, every agency, it's their right whether or not they want to report their crime data. It's not law that you report your crime data. So there was an agency, one was in timely reporting, and two was not reporting. So we were told, until we are in compliance, we're not getting the funding, or you will not receive the grant next year. So there was a lot of work ahead that we had to do to get in compliance. And like I said, it's not, agencies have their own right to choose whether or not they need to report their crime data.
So when they told you you were out of compliance, they explained you why you were and then what you would need to do to get into compliance. Is that correct?
They just told us, you're out of compliance. If you want your funding, if you want to get the grant next year, you have to be in compliance.
But did they tell you why you were out of compliance?
There was agencies that, one, wasn't reporting timely, and two, they weren't reporting.
I guess what I'm just trying to clarify that when they decide you were out of compliance, they let you know, and they told you what was wrong, and they gave you a chance to correct it.
Right, and once we got in compliance, then we were good to go.
Okay.
So we have to be in compliance with federal law. One, if this option number two were to be passed, the minute it comes on the books, the minute it's codified, then the city is out of compliance with federal law. Okay, we're not in compliance with federal law. At that point, I will not do another drawdown for the drug task force. So the city or somebody's gonna have to come up with those wages for those agents.
Sure.
Okay. What, can I make one clarification to that? I don't think the mayor and the chief have made clear to the public or to even the body here is that we administer the money for this area's drug task force, and it's our compliance that's required. But because of what you just indicated with the crime stats as an example, we actually tie the hands of the other jurisdictions as well. So the decision we make here actually for that grant in particular, just that grant, affects the reservations and the other counties and cities in the jurisdiction. So I just want you to understand that.
Sure.
We have some other implications here that go beyond the city of Havre. That decision could impact the grant for the rest of the whole task force that goes all the way to North Dakota. Yes, Elaine.
If I can make one more comment.
Is that right?
It seems to me that the perjury and grant and money issue is something that's up for debate. And I don't know about you guys, but I can't predict what our politicians will do. I just don't think that that's within my scope. What I want to remind you of is that the people here on the council, you have been elected to protect the interests of the city of Havre. By banning the dispensaries, the storefront dispensaries, you're not going to stop these people from having a business. You're not going to stop the people who have legitimate access and need for marijuana. And you are going to protect the city of Havre. And I think that's your job. Your job is not to worry about two businesses or six businesses or where they're located. You need to protect Havre, and that means banning it in the city limits.
I wanted to ask one question real quick about the federal, about Mr.
Chief of Police.
Okay, about the federal, okay, so if you're not in compliance at your city level with the federal law, then you won't receive your grant funds. But how does the state receive those grant funds that come federally?
The state's a pass-through entity, Deb. It's actually our grant. We write it, they award it.
Okay.
They're not expending any money. The individual jurisdiction is responsible for the drawdown, and the perjury request is signed by the chief, not by the state.
Not by the state. So the state has no federal
in that particular
requirements
grant
for compliance
all these
under federal laws.
But in that grant, he has to sign it.
So the state doesn't have to comply
no,
with federal laws.
No, it just
law.
Gets the money and sends it to him under his grant.
I think she's speaking more generally about any grant that
right.
the state receives.
I agree. I'm just saying they're all kind of different, but the one that he's referring to that's administered through Montana Border Crime Control is a federal grant through Border Crime Control pass-through.
So, yeah, so.
Responsibility for compliance is on the cities.
And all my grants either come from the federal government or pass-through through the state.
Through the state, so.
Either or.
Okay.
Both ways.
And so I just do not understand how a state can have the majority of the voters vote for yes, and then a small amount of people can come and decide that all those people who want access to their medicine, because you're supposed to represent all of us, not just five people or 10. And the federal applies to the state, but, and applies to the city, but it doesn't apply to the state when it comes to them receiving those initial funds. So they don't have to answer to any federal anything, just the cities do.
Right. The city's the one who's expending the funds, the state isn't.
So the state never asks for anything, they don't say what those dollars are for, they just say, we need this many dollars, and then the federal government.
No, because the grant, no, well, okay, I can't answer every single grant, because every grant is weird. The grant he's referring to, the request comes from him in the first place. So he's asking the federal government for the money, and he's the ultimate recipient of the money, and the compliance and drawdown happens in our jurisdiction. The state is merely it's just like the Board of Housing money that we receive. The city of Havre is the grant administrator for the Board of Housing money, but it's not our money. It's pass-through money. It just goes through our books and out. The ultimate grant recipient is some other entity, like Bearpaw Development, or Boys and Girls Club, or whatever the case may be. They're responsible for compliance. All we are is a pass-through entity. The ultimate body that is able to receive the federal money is the Montana Board of Crime Control for that particular grant. There are lots of grants that he uses. The fire department just is going through a $400,000 grant out of fire truck. The money, the revolving loan money that we receive for our wastewater treatment. Those codicils at the bottom that require you affirmative and you know, to verify your perjury allegation is on all of them, but they're all from different entities, different departments. It's all over. It's not just his. His concern is for his own budget, because I guarantee you if he doesn't get it or it is taken away, we would not have the money to put it back. So that's just one grant.
Right. So the bottom line is, one, we have to be in compliance with federal laws. It's there.
It says right at the bottom.
And two, the second thing is, the city is not trying to ban medical marijuana.
They can't.
No.
Right. Everybody said we'll have
they
their access
on that, like,
to
three
it.
Times, I think.
Right.
Yeah.
All right. So, to me.
So, okay. So I understand then, I guess. But the chances of that are, but we know that, I mean, all those other states.
So the chances.
Ma'am, I don't know that we do know that, and I don't know that we can afford to take the risk. That's why we're having this conversation. You may have that opinion. Caleb may have that opinion. I don't know that I'm comfortable with that opinion. I certainly know he's not comfortable with that opinion. And there's over 30 jurisdictions within the state of Montana that have already said we don't want to take that risk either, because I do think we have to admit that what this administration is just getting started. You know, they don't even have full, you know, every person involved in every secretary or every cabinet level position. I have no idea what they'll ultimately do. And it's not just the Department of Justice that receives it. You know, a lot of the money that you receive for fire department or for public works comes from the Commerce Department or the Department of Agriculture. It's nothing to do with the Department of Justice. And the coal memo that is referenced in the Rohrabacher Carr Amendment only applies to Department of Justice grants. The specific grant that law enforcement is receiving, whether we're talking about the Edward G. Byrne money or that money, that's federal money administered by the United States Department of Justice. So that has a specific implication to this conversation. But I think that's what it really boils down to. We understand where you're coming from. We want to be as accommodating as possible, but we do have this major concern that you all might think is a joke, but it's not.
No, we all.
We have responsibility
so we
to make that decision, because
vote.
If he doesn't sign it, then I have to sign it, okay? And so whether the mayor signs it, I sign it, our chief counsel signs it, or somebody has to sign it. I mean, I have to sign certain grants as president of the council. I don't know that I'd be comfortable doing that either. I'm not saying that I don't believe that it's a red herring. I'm not saying anything. I'm just saying we don't know. So we have to be able to deal with all of that.
So I think moving on a little bit, it sounds to me like the mayor is essentially saying option two here is not on the books, not on the table, or else he will throw away hundreds of thousands of dollars. So at this point, I think our choice is really the ban or nothing. Or a moratorium, but that would probably still be the same thing as acknowledging the existence of dispensaries at that point.
I disagree, actually. I don't think it would be that. Up until this point, it's been made, the point has been made several times, and I would like to actually discuss the moratorium issue a little bit. But this gray area, this area of non-acknowledgement, and Lucas, I thought your point was brilliant, actually.
Thank you.
Because basically what you did was you took the same idea that had been brought up here in several different ways, and you just twisted it around and used it again. It seems to me that, you know, obviously there's a lot of strong opinions, but it seems to me that there is a great deal of gray area. Doing nothing says one thing. A moratorium says, we're gonna leave things as they are, and we're gonna see if we can't get a grip on some of this, because this is a huge issue. There's just so many unanswered questions.
Sure.
Yeah.
And that's why some jurisdictions chose to do that.
I just have to take issue with you saying, you know, throw away this grant money. Because I believe we have a fiscal responsibility as a city council to do the right thing for the whole city. And we need to look at the whole picture, not just one little piece. And to say, oh, you're throwing it away, no, not really. We have to do what's right, whether it's popular or not. And to do what's right, unfortunately, right now, means you have to follow federal law, in my opinion. Because federal law supersedes state law. And I'd love to see that it all goes away and we can find it. But I don't think it's going to happen. And this is a really, really difficult time at the federal level. I don't think anybody knows what's going to happen in the future, because every single day something new comes down from the feds, and nobody knows what's going on right now. And I just think we need to be a little more respectful of the idea that this is a big deal.
Oh, it definitely is a big deal, absolutely. I just think that if the mayor is going to use grant money as sort of a cudgel in this discussion, I don't feel like that's very, very genuine.
But you have to understand that what he's saying is he doesn't feel comfortable. He feels that it's perjury.
Sure.
That's only for him to decide.
Sure.
We can't legislate by policy and say, we're ordering you as a public official for political reasons to perjure yourself.
Sure, sure.
So please respect that.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes, Brian.
Andrew, this is Brian Mullen again. I have a question that I've never been able to sort out. Maybe Gabe can help me with this. But if marijuana is a class one drug under the federal law and it's illegal to possess it, and if I've got a green card, it's illegal for me to possess marijuana under federal law. So if our police department, sheriff's department throughout the state of Montana has made the decision under state law that we are not going to enforce that, so they aren't arresting people. So by not pursuing and prosecuting and charging and trying to create federal issues, We're winking out of one eye and saying it's illegal under federal law, but we're not going to do anything. But it could affect our grant money if we zone it or don't ban it. And I don't see the difference. It's illegal under federal law. You either arrest and prosecute, or you're in violation of federal law. And we don't arrest and prosecute people with medical marijuana cards. So It's a bit of a shell game to say that we're going to zone or we're going to ban because of our risk of grant money, when we're already at risk because we don't enforce the federal law. So, how would you respond to that, Gabe? Because I don't have any idea.
It's a sticky wicket.
Yeah. In order to enforce the federal law, you have to have this federal law enforcement office to do that. Okay, so it's up to them to enforce that. We may have cases that we end up ultimately referring to the federal government, and whether or not they prosecute it or take it on, it's up to the U.S. attorney. But it's up to the federal government and the FBI or DEA or ATF or whomever to. And I can't speak as to whether or not on their behalf as why they are or they're not. I know when it all first started, in 2004, whatever, they were in question. And they did have some rights.
Yes, ma'am.
My name is Cameron Houston.
I'm sorry, what was your first name?
Cameron Houston.
Okay, thank you.
And, like, it's understandable that you're concerned with the federal issue. But I guess my question is you said that there was other cities that were concerned with it, so they banned it. But do you know what happened federally with the states that regulated it?
The cities are regulating
it. Or, yeah, sorry, the cities.
Yeah, nothing has happened. Well, most of them are less than a year old. We don't know. I'll readily admit that. The three jurisdictions that have done that have gone through the same process, and they determined that they were willing to take the risk. Bozeman, Missoula, and Silverville. The slight difference, and this is not a small difference, the slight difference between those jurisdictions and ours is that they have a rather intensive business regulation system where for the permitting, for instance, the city of Bozeman limits the number that they can have. We don't have any ability to do that. They have self-governing powers, so they can institute basically any ordinance they want that doesn't violate Montana law. We don't have that ability. We are a general government power city and cannot even become a charter, at least for one more calendar year. So there are some limitations in what they do, and they felt, at least in one conversation that I read about, I didn't actually have the conversation with the city attorney from the city of Missoula, they specifically said, we regulated it so much, so it was so intensive that we tried to run them out of town that we couldn't. And so they tried to regulate them into very specific areas of town. And so, but they felt that they had an affirmative defense because their zoning document is rather intensive. So that's what they've done in those three jurisdictions. They've limited it to very specific areas of town.
Okay, thank you.
I can't speak for them other than that.
Just one quick comment, How can we come together on this decision and have the city, the people of Havre, help the city come to the right decision? How can that happen?
So what we're going to do is we're going to take these two and we're going to mull them a little bit. Or maybe we'll have options again. I think maybe if it's in everyone's calendar, next week obviously is Thanksgiving, we won't be dragging anything for that. Maybe the last Wednesday of the month, I think, is the 29th. I don't think we want to wait too much longer because ultimately whatever decision we make here may end with the full council regardless because it's a big enough issue. So could we meet Wednesday the 29th and make some, at 7 o'clock, and make some kind of decision on what we want to do? And if Jay wants to propose a moratorium, I'll entertain that motion. I don't have a problem with that. But then we'll take a motion on one of the proposals and we'll vote on them. And if it ends up being 2-2, which I'm thinking is kind of where we're going a little bit, I don't want to pigeonhole anyone, but let's just say that it did. That technically, under Robert's rules, is a fail. I would then propose at full council that we take that up because I think we need to have this conversation. That may drag us into the new council, which won't give you a chance out. Because of the way that an ordinance, eventually required two votes would be needed. So this is not by any means over. We have multiple processes. So even if we took a vote tonight, folks, to propose one of the other, let's say we proposed an ordinance of one of the other, that would next be on the next council's agenda if the mayor chose to put it on the council's agenda for that meeting. And it would take two affirmative votes in those meetings, so at least two council meetings, so it wouldn't take effect until 2018 anyway. But I don't think we're there yet. I think we need a little bit more time to consider these and perhaps amendments to these. And these are just my ideas. I'm not saying I'm smart. I don't know anything. But I think these are simple. They're straightforward enough to talk about. So I think that's where we're at. Anybody have an opinion otherwise? Okay. So does that answer your question, sir? We've got a couple other opportunities for public
comment. Saying if there's any data or any kind of answer that you guys have not explored yet that could be mind for you guys through the public that have interest in this issue,
there's technically four options, which is one, we could continue to do nothing. I don't like that idea because I don't think it doesn't do a favor for law enforcement, and it doesn't really do a favor for the industry if they want to expand and grow. We need to give them an idea, because they're getting kicked out of other cities. So they not know what's going on here. I don't think, or think we're doing them a disservice by doing nothing. So, but that is an option. We could bury our heads in the sand and do nothing. We could do a moratorium and take up more of these issues. I had one individual tell me that perhaps we should request an attorney general's opinion on the validity of this whole mess. Technically, I don't think that would be valid here because I'm not sure what we would be asking Attorney General Fox to declare because he can only give an opinion as it relates to Montana law. He couldn't really make an opinion about federal law unless we were wanting to file a lawsuit for states' rights or something like that. But then, or we have to do some variation of these two, which is either a ban, a storefront ban, or a more defined spot zone ban, or a true zone. But there's a, I don't know how many cities and towns in Montana there are, of varying, you know, from towns to class one, two, three, and class one cities that have, some have done this, some are starting this process, some haven't done anything yet, but those are basically the four options. There aren't, there is no silver bullet. I wish there were. The problem is, and as Karen indicated, or tried to indicate, I think she said it to me at least once before, is that really your issue is with the federal government. The feds are going to have to figure this out because as difficult as some of it is for you, as because it's emotional, I get that, and perhaps anger at the chief or the mayor, you need to understand where they're coming from. They didn't create this mess, okay? This was created by an initiative process. Almost all of them have been done by initiative process in each state, which is totally legitimate, legal. It's in our constitution, it's used a lot. But it's illegal federally, it's legal on the statewide level, and it's legal in certain jurisdictions throughout the United States. Technically speaking, as you drive, if you were to take the Amtrak or drive along the High Line, you're going to be legally legal, legally legal, legally legal, legally legal. It's a problem, and we're just trying to deal with it. So, and I know you guys understand that, and I really appreciate your respect and understanding of the process we're taking up here. I hope you don't think that what we're doing is a joke, because it isn't. I've heard many comments about that, that they think what we're doing is a joke, and I take great offense at this. I haven't spent 10 years of my life on this body for nothing. And I don't believe anybody in this room believes that. And so I think that you do take this seriously, and we all do take it seriously, but there's a lot here to deal with. And I don't think that people should say for one side or the other that what they're doing is for inappropriate means. I think we all want to do what's right for our community, one way or the other. We'll make a decision, we'll come to some decision, and we'll live with it, one way or the other. That's the process. That's why we have this body, and that's why we have voting public. So, everybody okay with that? 7 o'clock Wednesday the 29th. We'll take some action. Thank you, folks.
We still
just go to the last question.
I had to come back.